speaking community theater in Indonesia, who held licensed productions of musicals and plays. And today we are on our second series, our second part of the Learn from Broadway program, where we team up with the U.S. Embassy. We also have our friends from the U.S. Embassy. Thank you so much for giving us the opportunity to learn from professionals who have been practicing their skills and their arts on Broadway for a long, long time, and is very gracious enough to share some of them with us tonight. We have kicked off this series just last week with our vocal workshop with Carla Canales, and now we have yet another exciting workshop for you guys. But before I go on forever about this, allow me to just introduce our amazing moderator. We have Erina Salim. Erina is a full-time brand marketer and freelance stage manager, and her passion for theater production developed during her studies in the UK, where she worked in 32 productions of different genres in various roles and departments. She also specializes in production management and lighting design, and was the technical manager for Paradise Green at the Edinburgh Fringe Festival in Scotland. Her theater credits include Hairspray, Into the Woods Company in Jakarta, and then in the UK. She has worked in Sister Act, American Idiot, the Riley Awards, Grease, and so many others. So please welcome Erina. Hi.
Hi, Ajeng. Thank you for that really nice introduction. Hi, everyone. Thank you for joining us. I'm really excited to be here today. Today we have a very interesting session lined up for you. I have spoken to Richard very briefly, and I can just tell you right now, guys, he has so much to share us to us tonight. So exciting. So I hope you guys are as excited as I am. Let me now introduce you guys to Richard. So Richard Hester is a stage manager, production supervisor, and producer. So yes, he wears many hats. He's a man of many talents. He is the supervisor for all productions of Jersey Boys internationally. So he's been all around the world with Jersey Boys. And Richard has worked on a lot of Broadway shows that I'm sure most of you will be familiar with, such as Gypsy, Sweet Smell of Success, Titanic, Phantom of the Opera, and many more. Richard has also done several national tours on, again, big productions that you guys will be familiar with, like Wicked, Phantom of the Opera, and West Side Story. And today we will hear from Richard, not only about his past experiences as a stage manager, but also what's coming up for him. So without further ado, let's welcome Richard Hester. Hi, Richard.
Hi, everybody. How's it going? I'm so happy to be here and be part of the JPAC presentation. It's an amazing organization, an amazing group of people, and I'm really honored to be invited to talk with you all today. Are we going to show that little film first, or should I talk first? What should we do?
Yes, I think, why don't we start with the film and then we can talk a bit more based on that. But before I hand over to the video, I just like to remind everyone that we do have interpreters here in the call with us. All you have to do is click on the interpretation icon on the bottom right hand side of your screen. We have two wonderful interpreters with us today, Linda and Mia. And also just another reminder, if you guys have any questions for Richard or for anyone else on JPAC, just shoot them in the Q&A box below, and we'll get to that later on in this session. Okay, so let's go ahead and look at the video.
Perfect. You'll notice I have a beard in the video. I shaved some back to work.
Hello, everybody. My name is Richard Hester. I'm a stage manager and production supervisor. I work and live mainly in New York City, but over the years, the shows I've done have taken me all over the country and all over the world. And it's been an amazing journey, and I'll give you a little bit of information about how it started. There was nothing really in my upbringing that made me think that I would go into the theater. I didn't even think there were jobs in the theater other than the people who were on stage. I saw my first show when I was about 14, I think, and I immediately fell in love with it. One day, as we were going home, and I was filing out of the classroom, going to the buses to take us there, our drama teacher was standing there looking for volunteers to work on the upcoming school musical backstage. And I said, sure. I didn't know what I was agreeing to. I didn't know what it was. I just said, sure. And from that little decision came a whole career. I worked backstage on Bells Are Ringing as the assistant to the props person. I just basically cleaned up a lot of stuff, and I loved it. I really loved it. So I worked on other shows, and the next year I was actually talked into auditioning, and I got in as an actor, and I acted in one of them. And then I acted in another one. And then we had some summer theater, and I started working backstage and on stage with all of those shows too. And I started realizing that it was something that I really wanted to do. So when it came time to choose a college to go to, I decided to come here to Columbia University, where I'm talking to you from now, which is in the Upper West Side of New York at about 116th Street. And to this day, I still live about 20 blocks away from here. I came up here because I wanted to live in New York more than it was that I wanted to come to Columbia University in particular. I studied theater while I was here. I did a lot of theater on stage and off stage, but I didn't really think that this is what I was going to do with my life. I thought it was a hobby. I thought it was fun. I spent my junior year in London, in England. And while I was there, I saw a million plays. We went 3 or 4 nights a week. We just saw everything we could possibly see. And I came back and I knew, I had decided that this is what I was going to do with my life. Now, my parents weren't all that excited about that, but they eventually figured it out and realized that it was actually a real job that I could actually get paid for and that I truly, truly enjoyed. I have been doing this for a very long time. In fact, I'm standing in front of the theater where I had my very first paying job in 1982, which is 40 years ago. So I wrote some letters and I said, I would be happy to work for free at your theater. And this theater, which at the time was called the American Place Theater, wrote back and offered me a job on one of their shows. I say job, but in fact it was for free. So I didn't get paid for it at all. The show ran for 2 months. I was an assistant. I did everything. I got coffee. I moved props. I cleaned clothes. I literally did everything. At the end of 2 months, which is also the end of our school year, they offered me $100 a week.
Hi everyone, I'm very sorry for the technical difficulty. I realized that the video is freezing and lagging. And so I'm gonna try to share the video from my end, okay?
At your theater. And This theater, which at the time was called the American Place Theater, wrote back and offered me a job on one of their shows. I say job, but in fact it was for free. So I didn't get paid for it at all. The show ran for 2 months. I was an assistant. I did everything. I got coffee. I moved props. I cleaned clothes. I literally did everything. At the end of 2 months, which is also the end of our school year, they offered me $100 a week to keep working on the show because it was a hit and it landed the summer. So from writing those letters, every show that I did came out of this one. It was a show called Bill Irwin's The Regard of Flight. And it got filmed for TV and I got paid for that. And I met a whole bunch of people. And those people hired me on other shows or recommended me to people in other shows. And suddenly I was doing this for a living. I had made a career. So one of the shows that I worked on at the American Place Theater was a show called A My Name Is Alice, which was a musical revue. I am now a couple of miles away from that theater. This is where the Village Gate was. You can see the old sign for the Village Gate just above that green awning right there. It is now, unfortunately, a CVS. It's not a theater anymore. During the 60s and the 70s, the Village Gate, along with many other theaters here in Greenwich Village, were the heart of New York's off-Broadway scene.
Okay, we've run into another technical difficulty. Really sorry about this, guys. We will be back really quickly.
I worked down here at the Village Gate for several years. I did A My Name Is Alice. I did a musical called Mayor the Musical. I did a musical called Ratmaster Ronnie. They were all cabaret space musicals. They were all very small musicals, and there were tables and chairs instead of seats. I learned everything, almost everything, that I know now from working on these shows down here. I went from working in not-for-profit theater up at the American Place to commercial runs down here. And we ran, whereas all the shows I did at the American Place only ran for maybe a month. I maybe had 32 performances. These shows ran for an unlimited amount of time. And My Name Is Alice was down here for at least 2 years. And the others were down here for almost as long. So I learned how to stage manage. I learned how to talk to actors. I learned how a theater worked and how it ran. So when I was still in school, I dreamed of working and living in New York City. I would come in with a friend of mine in the afternoons and we would see matinees. We'd come in on the weekends. We would get standing room tickets that were just a tiny fraction of the cost of regular seats. And we would come in and we would come into Times Square, and the excitement made me want to live here for my whole life. You can see this is what Times Square looks like today. We're not really fully open yet, but there's a lot of activity going on and there's a lot starting to happen again. On the ground here, these are all the names of all the different Broadway theaters. It's like a map. The dark gray line going across is actually Broadway, and all of these theaters are placed where they actually are on a map. So it's like a map of the entire theater district. And I knew this is where I wanted to be. I knew this is what I wanted to do. So this is 45th Street, which is one of the busiest theater streets anywhere in New York. you can see there's a whole line of theaters here, starting with this one, which is the Booth. I did a David Mamet play there. And the next one down is the Schoenfeld, where I did another play called A Delicate Balance. The next one in is the Jacobs. And I did my very, very, very first Broadway show there called Lend Me a Tenor, which was a play. It was a farce. And I was a production assistant, and I think I got paid, I don't know what I got paid. I got paid a very, very small amount of money to be there. But I was so happy to be a part of it and to finally be working on Broadway. And this street has always been one of my favorite places to be, even now during the lockdown. So this theater here is the St. James Theater. This is where I did my very first musical, The Secret Garden. Across the street, where I went soon after that, is the Majestic Theater. And it is here at the Majestic where Phantom of the Opera has been playing for 30 years. I was only here for about 6 months, but then I went on the road with it for about 2 years, and we were all over the country. This is the Lunt-Fontanne Theater. I've done 2 shows here. You can see that Tina, the musical, is playing here now. But before Tina was playing, I did a show called Summer, the Donna Summer musical, and we were in here. And many years ago, nearly well over 20 years ago, I did another musical called Titanic. And Titanic played in this theater for a couple of years. And you can see it's a very busy street. Over here is the Marquee Theater, just across the street. And this is where I did Annie Get Your Gun, starring Bernadette Peters. And then over here, you can see the 46th Street Theater, now known as the Richard Rogers Theater, where, of course, Hamilton is playing. So this is the Schubert Theater, where To Kill a Mockingbird was playing. But the show that I did here was Gypsy, starring Bernadette Peters. And we were in here for a year and a half. And I loved being in this theater. So during the 1970s and the early 1980s, Studio 54 was the place to be. It was a big, famous dance club, and everybody who's famous went there. Andy Warhol, the designer Halston. It was very, very famous. Now it's a theater. And in this theater, I did a production of Cabaret. I worked here several times. Once when I was doing a Patti LuPone concert called The Matters of the Heart in the big theater upstairs, and once in a much smaller theater downstairs with a Julie Taymor musical called The Transposed Heads. Julie went on to direct The Lion King all over the world. Here's what Lincoln Center looks like. This is the main theater here at Lincoln Center, where the ballet and the opera usually perform. I had a job at one point working with the American Ballet Theater in their office, and I used to come up here all the time and have to go backstage and deliver messages to the stage managers and to some of the dancers. And then over here is the David Geffen Theater, which is a huge concert hall. And here I've done concerts with both Bernadette Peters and with Patti LuPone. So this is the Gershwin Theater, where Wicked is playing. It's hard to see because the entrance is in an underground garage, but Wicked has been playing here for a very long time. I did Wicked on the road, on the tour, so I never actually did the show in this theater, but I did work on another show in this theater called The Red Shoes. It was one of the biggest bombs in my career. We rehearsed and previewed for 6 months, and we ran for about 3 days. We lost the full investment, which was millions and millions of dollars. It was terrible. It was a terrible show. I learned a lot doing it, but it was a terrible show. So this is the August Wilson Theater, where we did Jersey Boys for 14 years. We opened in 2004, and we were in this building day in and day out for the entire time. Across the street is another theater called the Neil Simon, where a new Michael Jackson musical was about to open. And you can see all the windows in the theater, and all the cast members, that's their dressing rooms. They used to yell out the windows to the casts of whatever show was playing across the street, and they would sing to each other. We called it a shout out at Saturday night on Broadway. It was really fun. We had a great time. So this theater, in a long, after the first year or so, I stopped actually being in the theater every day, and I started traveling around the country and setting up productions in different places around the country. And then I started setting up the show in different places around the world. And we went all over the place. We've performed in 17 or 18 different countries and with multiple different companies of the show, with different casts and different people. And my job was to put those shows together, was to recreate what we did here at the August Wilson all over the world. Okay, I'm sitting in Washington Square Park in Greenwich Village because I thought it might be a little quieter here. I didn't realize how loud New York was until I tried to film this. So those are some of the places that I've worked in and around New York City. I've worked at countless theaters all over the country, and as I said, all over the world as well. I have been fortunate enough to even work on a production of Jersey Boys on board a giant cruise ship, the Norwegian Bliss. We were performing when the shutdown started, and hopefully we'll be performing there again once we start up again. There are many different aspects to the job that I do, and I'll talk about all of that much more when we are together and we can talk in person. And I'll tell you about what my work is in terms of what the technical stuff is. But I'm a stage manager. I also produce some things. I work with an actress named Bernadette Peters on an annual event where every animal shelter in the area brings their dogs and cats down to the middle of Broadway, and we do a big adoption show where we get the stars of all the Broadway shows to come down and introduce all the individual dogs and cats to all the people who might be looking for pets. And we've been doing that online this year. I tour around with another actress named Patty LuPone and an actor named Mandy Patinkin, and they do concerts. And so I will stage manage their concerts for them all over the place. So there's many different things that I can do, and there's many different things that I have done to earn a living over the years. And I look forward to sharing all of it with you. But that's a little bit of who I am.
Wow. So that was very interesting content in the video. Richard, what a career you had. You've been working in the industry for a lot longer than I've been alive.
I think you're probably right. I don't really know where the time went or how all of that happened, but I guess it did. Go ahead.
No, you go on.
Okay. So what I was going to say is, at the moment, I'm now working on two different shows at the same time. One of them is brand new. It is a musical version of the movie The Karate Kid. And the TV series Cobra Kai that's playing now is sort of a sequel to The Karate Kid that's happening now. And the original writer of both the series and the original movie is writing the book for the musical. And we are in very early stages of creating that. And in September, we're going to do a workshop of it that no one will see, but we're going to, it's right at the very beginning of it. The other project I'm working on is we're going to do a filmed version of the stage version of Jersey Boys. So not like the movie that came out a couple of years ago, but more like what Hamilton is, which is we're building the set in the theater and then we'll film it. And then everybody, hopefully all of you in Jakarta as well, will be able to see it too. So I thought that what I would do is talk through what I'm doing on both of these productions so you guys can get a sense of what my job really is. So
yeah, that'd be great.
Right. In a lot of ways, when somebody asks me what a stage manager really does, My job is to make it so that everybody else can do their job. I try, if you think about it sort of in terms of a very, very fancy English house, where there's the people who live in the house, and then there's the butlers and the maids and the kitchen people who work underneath them. In a lot of ways, I'm a little bit like the main butler in the house. I'm the one who's running the house. I'm also the one who's in between everybody below stairs and everybody upstairs. So in a lot of ways, the butler in the house becomes the most important person because he knows what's going on everywhere, as opposed to the people downstairs who only know, the people who are the cooks only know what they're cooking, and the people who own the house upstairs only know what they're eating or whatever other jobs they're doing. So it is part of my job to coordinate everybody and to anticipate what problems might be. And there are always problems. We just had some problems with the audio and the video. And that's what happens every single day in the theater. There's always a problem. You can't stop problems from happening, but part of my job is, and part of what everybody's job, you know, on the panel here who's getting this, is to then fix the problem and get through it so that the show can continue forward. And that's what we did. We're here, you know, we've fixed the video problems and now we're moving. Okay, so when I get hired to do a job, the first thing I do is get to know who everybody is and get to know what people need and what is required. So for the Jersey Boys project, I know the show. So I'm in a slightly different position than I am with The Karate Kid, where we don't know what the show is. We don't know what it's going to look like. The first thing that you have to do is come up with a schedule. And it's a schedule that every different department has to agree on. And I'm going to show you what I'm going to use a lot of what we did for the Donna Summer musical, rather than what we're working on now, because it's already happened. So let's see, I'm going to share this now, which is this was from a tour of Jersey Boys.
And maybe while you're sharing, do you create the schedule? You create the schedule at the beginning, but then you tweak as you go, don't you?
Absolutely. The one thing that you can be guaranteed will happen is that things are going to change.
Yeah.
You do the best you can, and you have to figure out what you're allowed to do. Mm-hmm. When is the building open? Mm-hmm. When on Broadway, they're all different unions. There's the musicians mm-hmm. union. There is the crew union. There are the actors mm-hmm. union. They all have different rules about how long you can work. So this is for the second national tour of Jersey Boys. This was back in 2011. And so you can see here, there's usually about 4 weeks in the studio. And so for the first week on Jersey Boys, we only take the four guys who are playing the four seasons and we teach them music and choreography. So it's 10 mm-hmm. to 6. It's a very limited group of people, and they kind of make their own schedule within 10 to 6. They know they have to take an hour in the middle, but it's not all that set when that hour mm-hmm. is. They usually, the day before, they'll know that they're going to do music for a couple of hours, take a break, and then come back and do but they'll decide that and send out an email to all the actors the night before telling them what the day is going to be. So then at the top two here, we have the official start of rehearsals where everybody, all the rest of the cast comes in, and there's almost always a meeting, like in this case, the first hour is a union meeting. Then there's an hour of everybody getting to know each other, and they usually have like little snacks and food around. And then there's an hour of music, and then we did a read through. And then for the rest of the week, you can see there are the day is usually broken down into, there's a couple of days of music first, then there's music and dance, and then we do a little bit of what we call dramaturgy, where we sit around the table and we talk about the script. And in the case of Jersey Boys, we talk about the history of when Jersey Boys took place and what is going on around it. And that continues forward in the rehearsal room. We can do 8-hour days in the rehearsal room, and that goes on for until we get to tech. So you can see here in the studio, we do a final run, and then in the afternoon, they do what's called a Sitzprobe, where for the first time, they will hear the real music. And they usually go to a music studio somewhere, and the band is all set up, and the cast sings along with the band so they can hear that all they've had up to this point is a rehearsal piano. So then they hear that. Then we get into tech, and tech is a very long day. And this schedule is just fast, because in the morning from 8 to 1, the crew is working in there. And as the stage manager, we're dry teching, which means we're going through the entire show, cue to cue, all the lights, all the set moving, all of that stuff, without the actors on it. And then when the actors come in, we add the actors to it. And every morning before we tech, we want to keep ahead of the actors. So we get the raw stuff out of the way and then the actors on. But you can see here, if I'm in there at the morning from 8 o'clock, I'm not finishing till 10:30 at night. So they're very long days.
I always say that stage managers are really like the unsung heroes of a theater production, because we're always the first ones in and always the last ones out.
Always the last ones out. You're absolutely.
Yeah.
So everybody should, if you're going to be nice to anybody in the theater, you should always be nice.
Stage manager. Yeah.
Right. So the once we've got the schedule and we start working, what our job is to keep track of everything that's going on in the room. On summer, as we were working on the workshop, we started setting up what the scenes were going to look like. And so I started making diagrams myself of what the scenes were actually going to look like. And these are the diagrams that I made. I'm going to share that. So you can see here, I drew sort of by hand what it looked like. This is the keyboard. This is a drum. This is the surround of the stage. Mm-hmm. This is the keyboard comes on and then it moves downstage. The drums come on, it moves downstage. These squares are all four of them. This is a big elevator and these are three smaller elevators. And so this has a record player on the elevator. And that's what my version of that looked like.
Mm-hmm.
Then, let's see, I'm gonna share again.
And this block, that diagram, is that something that only you hold on to, or do you also share that to other members of your team?
I'll give it to everybody on the team. Mm-hmm. And then let's see, how am I doing this? Hold on, sorry. Are you seeing this?
It doesn't look like I'm seeing this.
So this is the real plan for that same thing that I drew, right? Here's the rolling keyboard. Here's the drum kit. And you can sort of see the slightly darker, the outline of the three elevators. This is what turned out to be, some of the things were the same, some of the things were not the same. So that's the real drawing. Okay. Mm-hmm. And now here is a picture of what it an actual picture of what it looked like. I'm going to share again. So this is what it looked like, computer generated from the front. You can see this is the keyboard, this is the drums, and you can see the holes where the elevators were, and sideways, but never mind.
A little bit of neck action for everyone.
There we go. So you can sort of see what things look like, what they ended up looking like. It was part of a process to sort of get. So the part of my job, obviously, is to sort of do that. Then what I need to do is block it. And the director moves the actors around. We need to keep a record of it so that when the director said, where did they go? And the actors can't remember the next day either. So the blocking script, which is originally done in pencil and pen and all of that, is then done. We then make a permanent version of it. Mm-hmm. That looks and like this.
Yeah. And this blocking is also important for shows that you want to repeat, right? So like shows that go on tours, show that go.
Yeah, so this production of Jersey Boys that I'm doing now, I'm gonna use some of this blocking that I took down 15 years ago. So, so you can see here the script is on the right and the blocking is on the left. So on this lyric here, Sue Ma on five, this person enters and is upstage at the number two fence. And it keeps moving forward like that. Now, we have a more exciting blocking script, which is, because when we started, this app didn't, this is called Stage Right. And Stage Right is an app where you can absolutely, hold on, let's see, share screen.
I just wrote that down because I've always only used like pencil and paper actually for my prompt books, just because it's faster to scribble. But then I always end up with the problem where I can't read my own handwriting, and then I have to go through and like make them look nice before the actual show.
This is Jersey Boys on the Norwegian Bliss, and this. Mm-hmm. Each one of these little icons is a separate actor, right? So the each scene, you can do as many as you want. You can see here, this there's an arrow that comes forward. That's where these are the three women who are coming on stage, and they're walking this way. They then all move downstage to that position, and you use the actual set plan and. Yeah. You can start putting all the exact blocking and on the exact word where it is. And we are almost at the point where we can animate what's going on stage, so that we should be able to create a virtual version of the show to really see where everything is.
Oh, yeah, so are the cues now just, do you just look at them from your laptop or do you still print them out?
No, I would still, the in terms of calling the show, I would still absolutely put them out. Yeah, it's too confusing, I think, to really be able to look at the screen. And if something goes wrong with the computer screen, it's
right. It's an alien nightmare.
With all of the calendar applications and all of the things, this is what I use. This is how I schedule Jersey Boys. It's all on paper and print out and do. So if it's not on, which kind of horrifies everybody I work with who really knows what they're doing technically, but I know that piece of paper is there and it works. It's not going to suddenly lose power or the battery is not going to run out or anything like that, because there's nothing worse than that, right? When you're stuck. So I can't get stuck. Let's write it down on a piece of paper.
I also prefer having things in my hands I can hold. And with the prompt book, Richard, I know that it's basically the Bible of a production, right?
Yes.
What would you say is the most important part of the prompt. Like, why is it so important? I mean, you mentioned earlier that it's so that we keep track of the blocking in case the director or the actors like forget what happened, because there's so many things going on in rehearsals. But are there any other reasons than that?
Well, you also want to know what's going on all the time so that you can always be ready to fix a problem. You have to know what everything is, and you have to know that in the middle of a show, when there's an actual problem and something gets stuck, if there's any way you can possibly get through it, then you need to get through it. I was calling a show once, one of the performances of Jersey Boys, and there's a song called My Boyfriend's Back. My boyfriend's back, it's gonna be trouble. Hey la, my boyfriend's back. So on those lines, I would have to say, my boyfriend's back, go. It's gonna be trouble, go. Hey la, go. My boyfriend's back, go. And each of those goes is a different light cue. And every single line of the song has that many light cues in it. So it's 16, go, 17, go, 18, go, 19, go, and you're trying that fast. And then you might have a line with nothing in it. So one day the drums got stuck. So I went, 18, go, 19, go, move the drums, 20, go, 21, go, but not yet, 22, go, 23, go, now, 24, go, stop the drums, 25, go. And so you have to kind of keep things going. You keep your eye on the drums. Know that if you move it any further, you're going to hit one of the actors. So hold the drum. The actor's now moved. Okay, now move the drums again. But you're keeping the thing going. And hopefully the audience never knows what's going on.
Yes, that's the most important part, isn't it? Just keep the magic alive.
Exactly. Now, the Jersey Boys has all of these fences that come in and out. And the drums are on a platform that's about maybe, 20 centimeters tall. So the drum platform moves upstage and downstage. And if you're looking at it sideways, the fence flies out and the drums move downstage, right? With the drummer on it, and the whole thing is moving. And then it turns around and all that. Well, one day, as I'm calling the show, there's so much going on. And you set up with the people who are operating the computers that move the scenery. Some of it is done just, pulling ropes, and some of it's So you set up cue lights. So you would say on the red light, you're going to do Q16, which brings the fence out. On the blue light, you're going to do Q18, which brings the drum downstage. And you're looking, you hit the first light and you see that the fence is moving. And so that now you know you can hit the second light because the drums are going to go downstage. Well, one day while I was doing Jersey Boys, I hit the first light and I saw that the fence was moving. I called some light cues, hit the drum. But what happened was the fence got stuck about this high off. So the drum, I didn't see that it stopped. I just saw that it started moving. So the drums then started moving downstage. But the fence was stuck. But the fence was just over the top of the platform. So the platform kept going. And the fence swept everything off as the platform went.
Oh, my God.
Loudest thing you've ever heard in your entire life. The drummer jumped off the back as soon as he saw what was happening. He was safe. He got out of the way. But everything knocked off. And you have not heard a sound like an entire drum kit being dropped on the floor. And it was so loud. And it ended with one of the cymbals going dead silence in the audience. 1,300 people watching this disaster happen in front of me. I had to get on the microphone and say, ladies and gentlemen, I'm sorry, but we have a small problem. Which of course made audience laugh.
The small and loud problem.
So in that case, we had to stop the show. We had to put the back together, which was all because microphones were all in a moment. It was a mess. And it took about 10 minutes to really put it back on. and the fence got bent, so it had to be unbent so it could fly in and out. And we said to the audience, okay, we're gonna bring the house up, please stay where you are, we're gonna fix it in a moment. Yeah. And I just kept talking to them so that people didn't get restless and start moving. But you always have problems that are coming up, and you really do have to deal with that.
We have a question from the audience that links to that, actually, Richard. So Albertus is asking, when things go wrong like that, and if it affects your motivation or your mentality, if it gets you down, like, how do you react to that? And how do you bounce back from that? Because it must have been a horror show watching, like, that whole drum set just coming off on your cue.
I think my reaction was, you have to stay in the moment no matter what it is, and you just have to go with it. Your job as a stage manager is to stay calm, is to really sort of say, okay, that went wrong, this is what it is. And that was totally my fault. That was totally my fault. Although there was no real way, there was nothing I could have done differently, because in that moment, so much was going on. I had to look away from the fence once it started moving. And the fact that it stopped was just an accident. So
yeah,
accidents will happen. And that's as much a part of the job as it going smoothly. So it doesn't really do anything to me, because that's what I'm trained to do. I'm trained to fix things as they're happening. And every single performance, something goes wrong. It might be tiny, but there's no such thing as a perfect performance. And you just have to just wing it. And sometimes you get through and you go, oh, that wasn't too bad. And then sometimes you get through and you go, oh, I'm glad that's over. And very rarely is something filmed. We were taking a recording when we were doing the show in Australia. Mm. We were a recording of the show to use as an archival copy so that we would have it. And we're filming. And that day, there's a scene where the three women in the show push tables out onto the stage for a scene takes place in a club. And the actors move the tables into position, and then at the end of the scene, the actors take the tables off. And that day, one of the actors was too excited and pushed the table right off the edge of the stage into the audience. It literally, that happened to be a show that we were filming. So we have that on tape. And she was mortified. But usually it's, you know, the thing with that's great about live performance is that it's happened.
You never, it's always like, it's always when you're filming a show when that something huge and noticeable actually happens. It's actually kind of funny and ironic.
Yes. And as long as nobody gets, I mean, I've certainly been in places where people have gotten hurt. That's not fun at all. And usually we are hyper aware of safety. So and hopefully you have a director who will, when you say to them, this isn't safe, we need to do it in a different way. Certainly the director of Jersey Boys, all he's concerned about is safety. When there are elevators on the floor that are gonna open up and somebody's standing next to it, you have to be, you have to make sure that you've put a mark on the floor, that the actor's is on that mark. And we have cameras looking down, so I can see that the actor's foot is in that mark. And if the actor is not standing there, I will not open the trap door. And there have been times when actors, there are also moments where actors look out for each other. The musical of Titanic, there was a big scene where there's this enormous set piece where everyone is sitting on top. And when the ship is sinking, the set piece is going, right?
Yeah.
And everything was open and there was only a rail upstage, and it was blocked so that no actor was more than two people away. You had to be holding on to somebody, to two different people at all time. person you were holding on to had to be holding on to the railing. So it was literally blocked that on this word, this person let go of this person here and held on to this person. And so there were 16 people on this platform, and everyone knew exactly where they were supposed to be at any given moment. Mm. Now,
yes.
Another part of my job is to train the understudies to be able to do exactly the same thing. And the act, they have to, if somebody gets sick, the understudies need to know where to stand so that they don't fall in the hole. They need to know which people they're holding on to, and they're in rehearsal and they're taking notes, but it's my job then to direct them into the show, because even if no one ever gets sick, people will take vacations. And so, you know, for a week, somebody else is on. So we create tracks for each individual person. And I'll show you this. So that, each individual person, this is a track for the track of the character of Mary. So, each number, she enters on stage right two, because each opening on the side is numbered, 1, 2, 3, 4. The on the top of the fourth eighth of music, she's going to enter stage right. She's going to exit stage left three. She's going to go to the stage left quick change room and change her clothes. And she's going to change her mic.
Yeah.
Then in the next scene, she's going to enter stage left one, and it's literally, so each actor has a complete track of what it is that they do. JN is the initials of the woman who is playing Mary. So that's where she sits at the table, and it goes through literally all of her costumes, all of her props, everything that she touches, everything that she does, all of her cues. So that I can hand that sheet to the actor, who then knows exactly where they're supposed to be. Now, you have to make that, obviously, because when you're rehearsing the show, you absolutely don't have time to do any of that. You only have time to do that once it's up and running. Replacing people, and then sometimes people, after, especially on a long run, people will leave and you have to put new actors in.
Yeah. So there's actually a lot of things going on in a stage manager's lives. Like, you handle so many things. You manage the cast, you manage your crew, manage the prompt book, because it's a whole other beast in itself. It's a lot of multitasking. So with all of those responsibilities, obviously you have to be really good at prioritizing, but aside from being calm and being hyper aware of safety, what would you say are other important qualities that a good stage manager should have? Like, and if you could pick only one, what would it be? Empathy. It's like a must have. It's like a make or break.
You have to have empathy. Almost everyone that you're going to work with in the theater is completely crazy. You have to sort of allow them to be out of their minds. When an actor is on stage and really doing their job, they're being vulnerable. They are open to anything. They have to be, their emotions have to be on the surface. And while there are plenty of actors who are, you know, absolutely able to control that, there are a lot of actors who don't want to control that, who want to keep their emotions on the surface so that they can get at them, so that they can use them as they need. So you have to be, when an actor is yelling at you, they're probably not you. They're yelling at their frustration because they can't find something. They're yelling at something that went wrong that wasn't anybody's fault. Whatever it is, you get dumped on a lot. And I think you have to be able to realize and not take it personally, that it's just, I worked with a particularly difficult actor. yelled all the time. And I went on vacation and I said, this person is going to yell at you all the time. I mean, all the time. And you stop listening to how the sound is coming at you and try and listen to what the sound is coming at you. A 5-minute tirade about something screamed at you could just be that they need the glass set 2 inches to the left for that scene. I mean,
it's simple.
And you just have to get through all that noise. Should people, we're in an interesting period in time, certainly here in the United States, where people are saying, no, you can't behave that way. Absolutely not. You can't behave that way. You're out. I don't see how you stop people behaving that way. It's too scary working in theater. It really is scary because there's so much unknown. And I think empathy, you just have to give people the space to be who they are. Now, mind you, if they're flipping out, you have to also get them to stop flipping out.
Yeah, it's very interesting that you mentioned empathy is the make or break skill to have, because I feel like a lot of people, when they think about stage management, they would think, oh, maybe you need to be organized or you need to be able to be calm under pressure. But I guess that really highlights that theater is, a lot of the theater industry is so based on a human connection, that really empathy is really like the one skill that will help you get through all the tough days and prevent you from going crazy, especially during tech week.
Yes. Well, I worked with an actress. For a long time, I got hired to work with people who were in really difficult, because I got known as somebody who could actually figure out how to work with people who were difficult. And I worked on this one show with an actress who was just angry all the time. Nothing was good. And she was a spectacular actress. Don't get me wrong. She was fantastic. But nothing was ever good enough. Everything was difficult. And we were working on this play that was set in India. And at one point, this guy gets mauled by a tiger. And he enters and he's covered with stage blood, right? You don't see the tiger, but it happens off stage and he comes on. Well, anyway, we're doing a run. And I'm in the booth calling the light cues. And my assistant is backstage running the deck. And anytime this actress got very upset, my assistant would turn on her microphone so I could hear what was with it, without sort of, telling the actress that I was listening, she would turn it on. So one day, there's everyone knows that there's going to be a photographer taking pictures for the program during this run through. This was fairly early on. This was like second or third run through. And the photographer's out there and taking the pictures, and the run through is going, and this actress goes off stage and is furious. Can't that person hear what's going on? I can't concentrate with all the clicking of the camera. This is nonsense. I'm not going back out. I refuse to return to the stage until the photographer is killed. I want the ears of that photographer on a plate if they can't hear what's going on.
Oh, that's horrible.
And my assistant's just kind of going, click, listen to this. So I happened to be eating an orange up in the booth at the time this was going on. And so I thought, So I took the rind of the orange and I made two ears out of the orange rind. I then went back, I put them on a plate. I went backstage and all the stage blood that guy used who gets mauled by the tiger, I put a handful of stage blood all over the ears. I knocked on her door and she said, what? And I opened the door and I stuck the plate in.
And this was like so funny.
Moments after, she had said, I want the ears of that photographer on the plate. We were best friends ever since. Literally ever since.
Oh my God. What a plot twist.
So you have to be, you can't use a rational response to say to this person, you knew there was going to be a photographer out there. We told you this, you can't be upset because you knew. That doesn't work. she's still a chef. You have to figure it out. And from then on in, I never had, there was never a problem. She would come to me and say, but she never once lost her temper ever again, because she knew that I was listening to her and I understood what she was going through. And that was a really good lesson to learn. And it was, I thought for a second, should I do this? Because it could have gone horribly wrong. She could have been furious.
Yeah.
It was so ridiculous that she actually just started laughing.
Just laughed. That's so funny. As you said earlier, anything can happen in theater. Okay. So I think it's time for us to move on to the Q&A part of this webinar. And you have a lot of questions already from the audience. So guys, I'll try to get through all of them. But if we can't get through them during the call, maybe we can type up the answers later on. So first question, Richard, is you've done stage management. You've been a stage manager for many, many years. Number one, what do you like about it? And like, why did you pick it over other roles? And I guess a follow-up to that question is, what has kept you in the industry for so long?
The good questions. I am bossy. There's something in my personality that I like to make things orderly. Like I'm gonna fix like this picture behind me. This one here is a little, and it's gonna be in a minute, and I'm gonna fix it. I might fix it right now. I like being able to put things into order. I like to know what's going on. I also, what I like about it is I get to actually work with every different aspect of the production. If you're acting, you can really think about what you're acting. If you're designing, you might be thinking about how the actors are going to interact, but what you're really doing is thinking about what the overall look of the stage is. I like being the person who goes to the costume designer and says, this costume isn't going to work because this actor has to do a flip. And if they've got that thing on their head, they're not going to be able to do a flip, right?
Yeah.
And then the designer says, well, that's too bad. They're going to have to cut the flip. And then I say, okay, well then you and the choreographer are now going to have a discussion together about let's see who's going to win. And you never know.
The costume designer, like to stir shit up.
Exactly. So I love that aspect of it. I love watching it being put together. I've been doing Jersey Boys now for 17 going on 18 years. And what's exciting to me is that every time we do it, it's different. If we do it we have to adjust things for each different space. The set of the Broadway show is very different from the set of the Norwegian Cruise Line version, which is in a tiny little theater. So we have to figure out how to change the blocking, how to, in some cases, cut down the cast and have fewer people play more characters. So because you can't cut a character, you can only cut the cast. However, on the Norwegian Cruise, we had to cut 40 minutes of material. And so having been with the show for so long, the music director and I did the cuts and then went to the director, because the director has worked on hundreds of projects since then. My job is different every day. Sometimes I'm casting, sometimes I'm directing, sometimes I'm teching. And so that keeps it interesting. And I think that's why I've been able to do it for so long.
Go on.
I was going to say, and I've been fortunate enough to work with some of the most fantastic people, people that I really admire. And being in the room with them, to know them, is also really thrilling. I love being around creative people.
Yeah, and I guess when you're spending like 8-hour days every day for years or months even, then that people aspect becomes so important for you and like for your job. In a follow-up to you working on different shows for many different years, there's another question actually that asks about when you do the world tours of Wicked, Phantom, and West Side Story, are there any differences in the working cultures and the ways of working? And how do you deal, if there are any, how do you deal with it? And how do you make sure that, you know, you're bringing this show from Jersey Boys from America, how do you make sure that that will fit in the culture of the country that you are in?
Yeah, well, with Jersey Boys in particular, when we're touring, even when we're touring around the United States, the sensibility of people in the South of the United States is very different from the people in the North. The people in the North tend to be much more liberal and much more, and especially on the coasts, like New York and Los Angeles, people tend to be very permissive about everything, whereas the southern part of the country tends to be more more conservative. So Jersey Boys in particular has a lot of bad language in it. And a couple of words that we don't use when we're in what we call the Bible Belt. We just cut those words out. Internationally, when we got to Malaysia, in Kuala Lumpur, we couldn't swear at all. The king was going to come and see the show. And so we had all the swearing out of the show completely. So we have a version of the script that we refer to as the F word, the F word free of the script. And
the
usually
F word what?
The F word free, so no F word.
Yeah.
But like even in New York, we had a sign at the beginning warning everybody that theatrical haze, gunshot, and authentic Jersey language is going to be used in this show.
Yeah.
Practically speaking, in terms of how we work, every single country has a different way of doing theater. And every single country, like if you say the words wardrobe supervisor to someone in that may not mean the same thing as somebody in Kuala Lumpur, that might not mean the same thing as someone in London or in New York. They're all different. And so part of what I have to do is I will say, who does this job in your country? Who do I talk to about a range of hospitals in this country? Because in London, I would talk to the company manager about arranging costume fittings. In Australia, I was a costume supervisor. So each has its own thing. They also have their own rules in terms of breaks. So in the United States, when you're working, you can work for an hour and 20 minutes, and then you have to take a 10-minute break. In England, you can, in a four-hour period, you have to take a 15-minute break in the middle. In Australia, you have to do the same thing, but you also then have to break 15 minutes before the end for everybody to get out of their costumes. And so I know from having done it so many times that it takes me 42 hours of the cast in costume on stage to be able to do the show. So that's not including the time it takes them to be on break or the time it takes them. So I will say, okay, Australia, I need 42 hours of the cast on stage. How many days does that spread out to? Because in Australia, in the United States, you could have 12-hour days for the week before performances. In Australia, you can never work an 8-hour day. So it's like, okay, I need more in Australia to get to the end than I do in the United States.
Yeah.
And we'll arrange the schedule around that. But I learned very early on, if I was doing a show in Jakarta, I would figure out how to work the way people in Jakarta work. Because it's stupid for me to come in and be imperialistic and say, well, this is the way you have to do it. This is the only way to do it. No, if we were doing Jersey Boys at JPAC, everybody working at JPAC has a way of doing it. And I would change the way JPAC is working.
Yeah, and I guess that really shows that, you know, being flexible is also an important part of the job. Well, I hope that maybe one day you'll be able to do a show in Jakarta, hopefully, and then that'll be so cool. I guess let's move on to a next question. So this question has a lot of likes. It's by anonymous, but the question is, and I think you answered this in your video, but I think you could elaborate a little bit more about it. How did you get to work in a theater? Do you need a theater major for that? I think in your video you said no, right?
Well, when I was coming up, there weren't that many theater classes. There weren't that many, you couldn't go to university and major in stage branching. It just didn't exist yet. A lot of the people who started departments in universities are my contemporaries, the people that I started out with. I learned by doing. I think it's still possible to do that. I will say that I never look at where somebody has gone to school, really. I've worked with stage managers who haven't gone to school at all and stage managers who have master's degrees in stage management. And honestly, what I'm looking for is empathy. I'm looking for empathy, a sense of humor, and an ability to be flexible and not get stressed about things going on. My friends who teach in university who know what I'm looking for will say, I've got a great woman for you, use her. Or I've got a great guy that's in this class, he's gonna be ready in 2 years. He's not ready yet, but he's gonna be ready in 2 years. And so I don't think you can learn how to make bloody ears out of orange peel. You have to just figure it out. But there are practical things you can learn in university. But I think to everybody who's watching, I would say everybody has their own path forward. If for some reason you can't get into university, then don't go. Figure out how to get some other way. It honestly doesn't matter.
Yeah. I never received any formal training for stage management. And it's exactly as you said, Richard, I found that the quickest and most effective way for me to learn all about stage management was actually by doing it and by asking tons of questions to people who are more experienced than me and learning from their experiences. I feel like it's really one of the industries where you need to just jump in.
Absolutely. And you need to work, you need to start working in tiny little theaters that don't pay anything, where, you know, someone, or on tours where it's like in the back of a rickshaw, where you just throw everything and then off you go to somewhere else. It is dealing with nothing where you learn how to deal with everything. When you have no resources at all, that's the best schooling that there is. Because then you have to go, okay, we're stuck here. What are we going to get that stick? And we're going to prop the light up with that stick. Okay, here we go. And then you actually get into a theater and you go, oh, I can actually buy a piece of equipment that's going to make that light stand up. We don't need sticks anymore. You know what's involved. And you know, I've worked with some of the best carpenters and people on crew that I've worked with are the people who literally when you're in the middle of teching a $10 million production, go, oh, we don't have the piece of equipment to do this. I'm going to go get a stick. And they go out and get a stick.
That's so funny.
Yeah.
Have you ever done that?
Oh, yeah. Oh, absolutely.
Lots of times? Yeah.
I do a lot of concerts with Patti LuPone, who's a very well theater performer and very, you know, she's won Tony Awards. She's at the top of her game. We got stuck somewhere. They set up her dressing room in a tent in a field. Well, it had the night before. And I mean, and the ground was all muddy, and her shoes that she used in the concert cost like $1,500. They were Manalo Blahnik fancy shoes. And she's like, she can't walk across the mud. And there were boys. She's like, I'm not going across the mud. So I had to give her a piggyback ride. You're like, jumped up on my back and I had to crawl across, which she thought was hilarious. So you just have to do it in the moment and just work with it.
Yeah, and you have to really be ready for anything.
Literally.
Because you're really like a butler, aren't you? You're just, whatever you throw at me, I'm going to do it.
Yeah, and exactly. I'm going to figure it out, and I'm either going to figure it out in an incredibly sophisticated technical way, or I'm going to hand you a stick and some tape and say, go for it.
Well, Richard, as a stage manager, what do you notice when you watch shows as an audience member? Do you notice when like people are propping a light with a stick and stuff like that?
The thing that drives me crazy is spike marks on the floor. And
yes, I hate them.
That's what I look at. And so like, especially when you go into a theater and there's no curtain, it's just the blank stage, and you're sitting there for 15 minutes waiting for the show to start. And I always look at the spike marks and go, oh, I wonder what's going to be there. And I wonder what's going to be there. And I wonder what's going to be there.
I wonder what that means.
So something is going to move on to there. And then like over the course of the show, I could go, oh, that's what went there. Okay, oh, man, gross. Okay, good. you can tell if somebody, especially on a musical, has an innate sense of musicality by the way they're calling the light cue. When the light cues are really landing where they need to go, that there's something thrilling about that. And I find it very difficult to watch a show when the person who's calling the light cue can't do it. Now, the problem is you also can't tell if it's the stage manager's fault or the guy pushing the buttons. You know, but part of our job is if the person pushing the buttons is delayed, is for us to then call the cue a little bit earlier so that it lands. And that's all part of the process too. So it kind of drives me crazy when that doesn't work. But my favorite thing is to watch a show and not think about any of it.
That's mine too. Just try not to think about any other things.
You sit there and you go, I'm going to think about all this. And then you're into it and you realize, oh, I haven't been paying attention to any of that stuff at all. I'm just in the story. Because ultimately, what we're doing is telling stories. And our job is to help make the story happen where nobody notices the little pieces that are involved in putting it together.
Yeah, I guess that's why we really, that's actually one of the parts that I love most about being a stage manager, is you do all of this work, but you don't expect anything in return. I certainly don't expect the recognition, but you know that everything that's happening on the stage wouldn't happen if you weren't there.
Absolutely.
I guess that's what,
we don't get the applause. That's, and in fact, if we're doing our job perfectly, like a head butler, if we're doing our job absolutely perfectly, no one sees us. And there's satisfaction when we're the last person leaving the theater and you kind of go, that was a good, nobody noticed us. Nobody yelled at us. happened. It got a standing ovation and everybody was happy.
Yeah, that's really the highest praise a stage manager can get. Okay, we have time for one last question. Let me pick a good one. Okay, give me a moment.
I'm looking for the question. I just
There's
see
so many.
Is there a good book to learn about stage management? The person who taught me is a guy named Peter Lawrence, Lawrence. And he has a book out about stage management. And I, for my life, can't remember what the title is, but he is a spectacular stage manager, and I would recommend that book very highly.
Cool. I will check that out. We actually now have time for one last question. actual one last question, because that was a quick one. But Richard, could you tell us about a time when there was like a big, not disaster, but like something went horribly wrong, aside from the drums, where people had to actually evacuate the theater? How did you react to that? And does it happen often?
It doesn't happen often, thankfully. There are times when we were doing the musical of Titanic, the technical aspects of the show were so complicated that we kept having to stop the show. And we it happened all the time. And in times like that, we actually had to, you know, there are times when we said, okay, we're gonna stop for about 20 minutes, please go back and have a drink at the bar. Most of the time you wanna, if you stop, it's like for a moment. There was a moment on the tour of Jersey Boys in San Francisco when there was an earthquake and during the show. And one of the guys in the show stopped and said, okay, everybody, we're fine. We just had an earthquake, but we're gonna check everything out. It's going to be good. So everyone, we're all gonna leave the stage now, and it's all gonna be fine. Don't anybody panic, just stay where you are. It's gonna be great. And the characters are like, what are you doing? This is San Francisco. They have earthquakes like this every 10 minutes. Get back out on stage. Don't ever stop the show again. It's not your business to stop the show. It's the stage manager's job to stop the show. If the stage manager doesn't stop the show, then just keep going. So he had never experienced an earthquake before, but everyone in the audience who lives in San Francisco had earthquakes every day, so they didn't care. And it wasn't even that big an earthquake. It was like a 4. So it was just like a little rumble, and then off we went. You know, things shook a little, and then it was over. So the drum kit, honestly, was the biggest thing that I've ever seen, that I've been personally involved with. There have certainly been incidents on other shows where people were seriously hurt. There was an actor on one show who fell through a trap door and never really been able to walk without a cane ever since. There was on the Spider-Man musical, I think there was somebody who was really seriously injured during that. I'm very grateful, knock wood, that I've certainly been on shows where there've been people hurt, but never to the point that they weren't able to recover. So
yeah. Very Yeah, and I guess that's also a testament to how good of a stage manager you are, having all your eyes and ears peeled at all times. Well,
it's also luck. You have to sort of luck too. Because I very easily could have been on one of the other shows where somebody got hurt. Mm. And it's an awful feeling when somebody actually does get hurt.
Yeah, definitely. Okay, well, that was kind of a heavy question at the end, but I hope that gave everyone in the audience a true look into what the life of a stage manager is really like. What are Richard's highs? What are the lows? And I hope that it has really enriched everyone's knowledge of the industry in general. That is all the time we have today for questions. I see that there are still a lot of questions in the Q&A. We'll try to get to you after the call, just by text. But before I hand over back to Ajeng to help us close, Richard, thank you so much for spending your morning with us. It's been such a pleasure.
Arena, it's been really a pleasure for me too. I'm so happy to have gotten to know you a little bit, and I really hope that someday we really do get to work together. It would be really fantastic. Yes.
Either in Jakarta or New York or one of the other countries that you go to.
Exactly, somewhere in between.
Thank you, Richard. Now back to Ajeng.
Right. Thank you so much, Arena. Thank you so much, Richard, for sharing with us. It's certainly such a pleasure, such a joy, such a treat to hear all those stories and to learn all of that. in such a limited amount of time, we do hope that we get to talk more with you one of these days. To answer Farah's question, yes, the question is being live streamed on YouTube right now, and it will be available after this. So you can go check that out after the session's finished. I would just like to close the show by saying thank you so much for everyone who attended the webinar, who sent in questions. Richard, if we were to have more questions for you, how can we reach you?
If you all could email me, I'll put my email in the chat. And feel free, there's probably 8 million people out there, but I just sent you all my email address. So feel free to ask questions and I will do my best to answer them. And for any aspiring stage managers out there who end up coming to the United States, please send me your resume.
Awesome. Thank you so much, Richard. So that is the end of our second Learn from Broadway workshop webinar. Our third webinar will be in July, but don't you guys worry, we have something in the line for us. We will have the last 5 years, I believe we mentioned that earlier. We will have the last 5 years, our first ever online production, our first ever time recording, professionally recording our stage production and streaming it and making it available to stream. It will be on Kiosks at June 25th to 9th of July. Every night at 7 p.m. WIB, Indonesia time, Western Indonesia time at Kiosks. Do check out our social media. And so this is still about a couple weeks away. Before this, we will have our own JPAC Academy recital as well, performing the last 5 years. We will have 19 amazing performers who have been working with us for 3 months, who have been learning the basics of acting and musical theater performance. And they finally got to show what they learned and what they got in the last 5 years recital. And when is that going to be, Rio? It is going to be, it's going to be streamed starting from June 17th to June 24th, also on Kiosks. So do check out our social media to get your tickets. And why don't we watch the trailer for a bit, yeah? Thank you so much. So that will be the last 5 years. Do check it out and check out our social media for our latest news as well. And one last thing before we go, we will have an exit survey when we log off, when we leave the webinar. So please do spare an extra couple of minutes to tell us how we can make this better, make this overall a better experience for you guys. Thank you so much. Have a good Saturday night or a good Saturday morning, and we'll see you very soon. Bye-bye.
Elphaba, why couldn't you have stayed calm for once instead of flying off the handle? I hope you're happy. I hope you're happy now. I hope you're happy how you hurt your cause forever. I hope you think you're clever. I hope you're happy. I hope you're happy too. I hope you're proud how you would grovel in submission to feed your own ambition. So though I can't imagine how, I hope you're happy right now. Elfie, listen to me. Just say you're sorry. You can still be with the wizard, what you've worked and waited for. You can have all you ever wanted.
I know.
But I don't want it.
No.
I can't want it anymore. Something has changed within me. Something is not the same. I'm through with playing by the rules of someone else's game. Too late for second guessing. Too late to go back to sleep. It's time to trust my instincts. Close my eyes. Can't pull me down.
Can't I make you understand? You're having delusions of grandeur.
I'm through accepting limits, 'cause someone says they're so. Some things I cannot change, but till I try, I'll never know. Too long I've been afraid of losing love, I guess I lost. Well, if that's love, it comes at much too high a cost.
Come with me. Think of what we could do together.
Unlimited. Together we're unlimited. Together we'll be the greatest team there's ever been. Glinda, dreams the way we planned them. If we work in tandem, there's no fight we down.
Well, are you coming?
I hope you're happy now that you're choosing this.
You too.
I hope it brings you bliss. I really hope you get it and you don't live to regret it. I hope you're happy.
One, two.
no wizard that there is.